You're about to see part two of Absolute Truth. Again, as I stated last week, this message, if you don't have absolute truth, then there is no truth at all. It's a lie. So stay tuned. Don't turn the channel. You've got to hear the message of absolute truth. Get your Bible out, follow the scriptures with us, and let God just speak to your heart and to show you and enlighten you, because He is the truth.
Let's go to John 17, verse 17. We're going to a lot of scripture. I want to talk to you about absolute truth. Absolute truth. Now, I can say those words, and I have, and as I was doing them, the Lord says, half the people don't even know what absolute truth means. Jeremiah 7:28. You shall say to them, this is the nation that did not obey the voice of the Lord. Their God or accept correction. Truth has perished and has been cut off from their mouth. Let me ask you something. Why has the suicide rate increased by 40% in the past 10 years in America? Why do we have an opioid epidemic? Why are basic values like respect and honor almost extinct in our society? Why are elementary schools now dealing with young children wanting to end their lives because at 8 and 9 years old, they have no hope and see no future worth living for? Jeremiah gives you the answer. Truth has perished. Church, we are the ones called to step into the gap. We're the ones called and appointed at this time to speak the truth to a discouraged, a despondent, a deluded society. That they might know the truth, so that the truth can set those little ones free. Can give them hope, and they see a way out, and they see value in their life. Only Jesus Christ can do that. And if we call ourselves Christian and live like hell, we have done a total disservice to the kingdom of God. Here's the problem. As long as we stand on the Word of God, we are perfectly invincible, impregnable, and immovable. In case you don't know what those words mean, let me tell you. Invincible, too powerful to be overcome. Impregnable, unable to be captured or broken into. Immovable, impossible to move. As long as you stand on the Word of God, that's who you are. That's a shout time. Yes. You know, we believe truth. We say, you know, there's truth we know for sure, and there's truth we live. Amen. Which don't go together. Amen. One of them's a lie. Amen. If you live the Word, absolute truth. Yes. But if you're living your interpretation of the Word, through your eyes and not the eyes of the Lord, then you're walking in false reality. That's not real at all. Do you know why worship is so powerful? Because when you and I worship the Lord, we are expressing the greatest truth known to mankind. That God is good, that God is faithful, that God is trustworthy, that He's everything we need, desire and hope for, and that He only speaks the truth. He is the truth. That's why worship is so very powerful. Worship is the most truthful thing we do on earth. Need to write that down somewhere. The most truthful thing you will ever do is to worship God. Then you need to ask the question, what does this truth have to do with the meaning of life? In case it comes across kind of vague, let me talk to you about four absolutes. I already told you what an absolute was. You know, unchangeable, cannot be changed. A fact, for sure, that's just the way it is. No matter whether you like it or don't like it. No matter where you put your money on it or not. It's just that way. Absolutes really matter, my friend. Even though much of our society, as I read, doesn't believe that absolutes matter at all. Where are we headed? Absolute is a value or a principle that will never change. You can't have a 99.9% absolute. It's 100%. It's 100%. And the only place you'll find an absolute is in the Word of God. There is no other absolute. Four absolutes. Four convictions that spiritual giants of the past held on to. Truths that brought them through persecution, that helped them, the martyrs, stand on. Let me give you just four of them. One, having a right definition of evil. Webster Dictionary said it is a profound immorality and wickedness, especially when regarded as a supernatural force. Interesting that Webster would throw that in. Have you noticed that the world doesn't like the word evil anymore? Matter of fact, they've made a TV program called Evil because it doesn't have any really connotations to it. And plus, it's not politically correct to talk about evil. Nevertheless, evil is real. It's horrific. It cannot be medicated away. The only remedy is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Did you know that at one point during World War II, 12,000 people a day were murdered in Auschwitz? In that camp in Poland. 12,000, that's just Jews, basically. 12,000 a day. Did you know we knew what was going on? Through some of it. Got mighty quiet, didn't we? There's a plaque, if you can believe this, at Auschwitz, with these words of Hitler. It's there now. It says, "I freed Germany from the stupid and degrading fallacies of conscience, of morality, while we train young people before whom the whole world will tremble. I want young people capable of violence and perilous, relentless, and cruel." That plaque is still there. Still there. And in one of the speeches to his brown shirts, which were the youth of Hitler, see, some of you don't even know anything about Hitler. And matter of fact, did you know that even during the meeting last week that one group called another group and addressed someone as Hitler? Yes. In a Senate hearing. If you're not appalled, what are you? One of the speeches to his brown shirts, Hitler said it this way, "I want to raise a generation of young people devoid of conscience and cruel." If you can't remember the past, you can repeat it. So that's why they're trying to do away with anybody remembering anything pertaining to history. Oh, there's so much. Did you know that the world puts toleration above righteousness? Oh, think about your own self. You know what's right. But we tolerate it. Tolerate it in your job. Tolerate it in your house. You tolerate it on television. You tolerate it. Tolerate it when you go to the polls. Because to tolerate is better than being just righteous. I mean, righteous is so straight. Evil in all of its form is real, and no political commentator or modern philosopher can change that. It's either the whole truth or no truth. There is no gray zones. I've already said that. And as we shake our head as if we don't know anything about it, don't you forget that the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life are still active tools that Satan uses against us. So the first absolute, evil exists and must be clearly identified and recognized. Sin is sin. Listen to me. Sin is sin. It's not a disease. It is not a disorder. Sin is sin. Amen. Well, I'm sure I made a lot of people mad there. That's an absolute truth. Second absolute. We must have a right understanding of justice. Without truth, there is no justice. Surely you've heard about men and women unjustly imprisoned, and through years and years, and some eventually were exonerated. A great deal of them died in prison unjustly. Why? Because truth never surfaced. Just because truth kept hidden. So liars snuffed out truth. And there wasn't enough standing for truth to overcome it. Justice is an attribute of God Almighty. His justice demands that he judge us. And who of us could stand before his judgment seat? No one. Do you know that in the Old Testament, why Israel and Judah were captured, there were three basic reasons: idolatry, immorality, and disunity. You better write those down. I've given to you many times over the years. No one, yet the Word of God, this is amazing. The Word of God says that in Christ we are blameless. Not innocent. Blameless. Do you get how incredible that is? Let me tell you what blameless means. Blameless. Above reproach, guiltless, innocent of wrongdoing, lily white, faultless, impeccable, righteous, cleared, vindicated. And as we stand before God Almighty because of what Jesus did, we are considered blameless. Whoa! That is amazing. I don't think we can even process it. In the five previous messages, and with the first one, we talked about the hidden in his first coming are patterns for his second coming. Now, I did not give that title. This was something the Lord spoke to me about, and so I'm just quoting what he says. And so there are patterns that are there. And in the first one, the first pattern, if you can remember the patterns, the first pattern had to do that he, in the first appearance, he appeared to the elder, to the senior citizens first. All that means is that you should not be surprised that a lot of senior citizens are beginning to talk about the appearing of the Lord or the rapture. It is a biblical principle that when it's time for the Lord to return, he will begin to talk to senior citizens first about it. And begin to, those who will speak it, those who belong to him, those who are involved in the word, those who understand. Second, we talked about God always keeps his promises, and we talked about John the Baptist, as well as all the other things that are involved there. And the third one, we talked about the powers of faith, talking about Mary, what great faith Mary had, and all the other folks that were involved in faith. The fourth one, he prepares his people. He wants you to know that he's coming. And we went in detail. All of this is still in chapter 1 of Luke. And number 5, of course, was how's your spiritual discernment? That was Christmas Eve, talking about, in particular, the information regarding the innkeeper and what all we learned from him and all the different signs around, how Jesus can be knocking on your door, absolutely trying to minister to you right and left, be right in your face, and you miss him. because you're not expecting him, because you're more tuned to the flesh than you are to the spirit, and to warn you that it is a season and a time above all times to be spiritually attuned to what is happening in the world today. We should be thanking God every single day that his mercy has triumphed over his judgment. It says that in James 2:13. It says, "For judgment will be merciless to one who has shown no mercy, but mercy triumphs over judgment." Amen. Y'all, that's your God. Amen. Jesus took your judgment. He became the guilty party, so you are blameless. Yes. We're talking about in the sight of God Almighty. Praise God. Did you know that every liar is a thief? Yes. Why? Because every lie is a way of obtaining what is not rightfully yours. Maybe I should say it again. Every liar is a thief. Because every lie is a way of attaining what is not rightfully yours. I know some of you would like to leave, but the doors are locked. Jesus took on himself what the justice of God could rightly have put on me and you. But instead, he said, "They're blameless. You will stand before God blameless. Eternal justice was satisfied on your behalf." And if that truth ever really grabs you, gets you in the core, you will be fundamentally revolutionized forever. You are blameless. Number three, absolute is love. The world has no clue what love is. Listen to me, there's no such thing as free love. The term free love is a contradiction in black ink on white paper. It's wrong. Love was never intended to be free. Love by nature means, and this is where you're going to just really sweat, I guess. Maybe you'll perspire, but I believe it'll go all the way to sweat. Love by nature means commitment. Love by nature binds itself so that when you say "I do," you're also saying "I don't." What do I mean by that? "I do take this woman as my wife" means I don't look around for somebody else. Or vice versa. But that's what "I do" means. It has "I don't" attached to it. People don't care about that anymore. I've had people say to me, I said, "Do you think this is going to work out?" "Well, I don't know. If not, I'll just get a divorce." Before they got married. I didn't marry him. I didn't perform the ceremony. Love only exists in an atmosphere of truth. Listen to me. Emotion is not love. No. Lust is not love. No. Feelings are not love. Love may include emotion, but love is by nature commitment. God was committed. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." God Almighty was committed by his love to get you back. And he gave everything he had because of his commitment of his love to get you. We don't have any idea what it cost. The greatest love ever expressed was at Calvary. And listen to me, Jesus experienced no butterflies on the cross. He didn't have any gooey, gooey, gooey emotions. He didn't have any warm feelings. But no greater love has ever been seen. He gave his life freely, but the love that took him to Calvary cost him everything. Are we worthy of the cost? Are we really worth in God's sight we are. Is that not amazing? I may not think you're worth it. And you may not think I'm worth it. That's an opinion. An absolute is, in God's book, you absolutely are worth it. Emotions scream for personal satisfaction. Love looks for ways to give to the other. Love is a critical element in human life. Love of God, love of family, love of friends. You cannot love anybody. You will never learn to love anybody until you learn to love God. Amen. The fourth absolute, forgiveness. Yes, it's an absolute. Why is it an absolute? Because there's no life without it. Amen. Oh, you can exist, but you can't live. You can't live without forgiveness. It's an absolute, for we all need to receive it. We all need to give it. And only in the cross do we receive it. And only through the cross can you give it. Amen. Yet if you don't walk in any kind of forgiveness, offer any kind of forgiveness, you do not really exist. You're just... There is no other true worldview than the cross of Calvary. Yes. It's the Son who sets us free. It's the Son who is the way, the truth, and the life. Truth is not an idea. Truth is not simply mental assent to an external reality. Truth is not a proposition. It's nor a philosophy. Truth is a person. Yes. Truth was not just what Jesus said. It was who he was. Yes. Jesus is the only truth. A person who perfectly lived out eternal truth, and in so doing, this is what Jesus did for you. He became the living expression of the unambiguous confrontation with evil. Let me help you understand. He became the truthful, the hit straight on, the frank, the straightforward confrontation with evil. He did not pussyfoot around. He became the uncompromised application of justice. It could not be bargained. He became the unconditional outpouring of love. It's not subject to any condition. No matter what happens, it's still there. And he became the unmerited gift of forgiveness. You didn't earn it. You don't even deserve it. But he gave it. So truth resides on those four pillars. And they're brilliantly summarized by Jesus in these words. John 8:31. If you continue in my word, then you are true disciples of mine. And you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. That same John recorded later in 3 John 1:4. He said, I have no greater joy than this, to hear my children walking in truth. Now, you might have expected him to, I could hear nothing better than hear my children walking in love. But that's not what he said. John had a lot to say about love, but he understood a basic principle. Unless you know and live the truth, you will never be able to walk in love. Amen. 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 True love cannot be found in someone who does not know Jesus. I cannot say it any clearer for those of you who are looking for somebody and thinking you go change them. If they do not know Jesus, you do not have true love. Truth is a rare commodity in today's world, but it must not be rare in the church. Amen. Truth of God's word must never be compromised. The truth of who we are in Christ must never be minimized, and the truth of the calling of the church must never be ignored. There's no such thing as compromise when it comes to absolute truth. Let me remind you of a thing as I close. Remember this. If Satan can get you to believe a lie, he has you and your entire life moving in his direction. Satan's power is in the lie. And when his lie is exposed by the truth, his plans are foiled and ruined. We do not have to outshout him or outmuscle him to be free of his influence. We simply have to out-truth him. Yes. Believe, act, declare the truth of God's word, and you will mess up everything Satan is trying to do in your life. The scriptures support it. Greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Be not overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Thy word is truth, absolute truth, unchangeable, unmovable, always the same, a fact beyond question. That's the way it is.
Thank you for watching our program today, part one and part two of Absolute Truth. If you'd like to hear it again, you can call and order the messages, or you can go to our website at sandrakennedy.org and go to our archives section under media, and all of our services, probably for 6 months, is there that you can just feed upon the word and feed upon the word. Our worship is there as well, and I would trust that you would be blessed and enriched, and the presence of the Lord would engulf where you are. If you are there and you're maybe watching in a hospital room and you feel like all hope is gone, I'm here to encourage you today. There is hope. His name is Jesus. He has not forgotten you. He is not mad at you. He loves you. He is on your side. Call our prayer line. Our prayer warriors are there. They will stand with you. They'll pray with you and touch heaven on your behalf. And then we expect to hear back from you with a glorious praise report here at Sandra Kennedy Ministries.
Arise, shine, for your light has come. You are called to walk in the light as Jesus is the light. There can be no compromise. It is only by yielding to God that you can thrive and break through the darkness as light.
It's time to shine. From the inside out.
Sandra's 4-CD series will give you nuggets of truth to stir up change in the depths of your being. Call or order online. It's time to shine. And for a gift of $24, we will send you this 4-message series. We'll be right back.